Well, thank you, Claudia, for your kind introduction, and thank you to the Vice-Chancellor for being here, and thank you to all of you for coming for this talk, which seems to be trying not to be too scary. It's actually 50 years to the year since I left Sussex with my doctorate, and in fact, I was only here for a relatively short period of time, between 70 and 72. But during that period, I made the acquaintance of two people whom I regard as mentors in my work. Going to be a bit tricky. On the left, Anthony Lowe, who was at the time not just my supervisor, but Dean of the School of African and Asian Studies, when there was such a thing here at Sussex, and later on Vice-Chancellor of the Australian National University. And on the right of the screen, Ranjit Guha, who I didn't know particularly well at that time, but I got to know some 10 years later through association with him and the Southern Studies, a group of scholars who were interested in working on the histories of people of the subordinate classes in India. So I like to think that the nature of my work over these 50 years, and indeed the nature of my presentation today, reflects in some ways the work of these two scholars. I think of Anthony Lowe's work as being particularly about imperial policy, about what empires did or thought they were doing, particularly in relation to the emergence of nationalism in India or elsewhere. And Ranjit Guha took a very different perspective on the history of South Asia by looking essentially not at imperial policy at all, except perhaps as a source of oppression, but was interested in the nature of subordinate classes, particularly the moments of revolt and rebellion. So I think you find some evidence of both those lines, the imperial policy and the subaltern activity, in my talk today. What I'm trying to do in this talk is to bring together three things. I'm trying to look for a moment of conjuncture between three elements, which I think particularly revolve around this period of the 1890s and the 1900s. One element of that is disease. Epidemic, in this case, pandemic disease, in the bubonic plague pandemic, which began in China in the 1890s, spread through Hong Kong, and then to Bombay in Western India in 1896. This was a massive disease episode in the history of India in particular, and over the course of the following decades, probably in the region of 12 or more people, million people, died of plague into the 1930s and 1940s. So looking at a very seminal disease episode. But secondly, I want to tie in with that a gender history, the history specifically of women as doctors and nurses. And I would be inclined to argue that this was the first time in any pandemic that women as doctors and nurses played such a significant and high profile role. And the third element of my discussion is in relation to photography. And photography really is the means by which I try to enter this particular historical moment. And I'll come back to the significance of that in just a moment. What I'm also trying to engage with here is the nowness of the past, the relationship between an event happening some decades ago, and more recent events. And I will not be alone in suggesting to you that there are close visual similarities, as well as social, cultural, and political similarities, between what happened in India in the 1890s and 1900s, and the pandemic of COVID in India and elsewhere in 2022. In a sense, what photography does is to bring home to us many of those crucial episodes in the pandemic of the past, as well as in the more recent past. So scenes of panic and flight, scenes of people being forced into certain kinds of sanitary measures and procedures, people going to hospital, getting from hospital, people dying on a massive scale, scenes of death, cremation, and wholesale suffering. So there are certain ways in which history revisits episodes from the past and translates them into the present. But at the same time, I'm very aware of the way in which things also change. I'm talking about the 1890s here, essentially. I'm talking about a moment at the height of the British Empire in India. And there are many things about my presentation which perhaps are not replicated in more recent times, but which speak to the specific nature of India in that particular colonial moment. And focusing upon one individual, you saw briefly in my previous slide, Dr. Marion Hunter, I am perhaps particularly accentuating the nature of a set of circumstances which were peculiar to that moment in time and haven't been replicated since. So let's begin to think about the nature of the photographic archive. The photography had been around in India since the 1840s, but in a sense it came of age in the 1890s. By the 1890s, there was more mobility and versatility in photography than there had been in previous decades. And although there are some representations, photographic representations of disease and medicine before the 1890s, this pandemic in Western India, particularly in the 1890s, was the occasion for an extraordinary effusion of both Indian and European photographers, by photographers working for the state, as well as photographers working for newspapers, for other media outlets. And his work covered a great range of situations, from street scenes like this, going to the inspection of buildings in Bombay, to inspections taking place of third-class railway passengers at railway stations. And many of these measures were thought to be very intrusive, very much focused on bodies of the individuals concerned. And the destruction of buildings. This is Karachi in about 1897. And you might notice in the center here, the walls have been marked with circles with crosses in metal, much as they were in this country in the 1660s, to mark cases of plague. And in fact, in some of these photographs, you see entire doorways with dozens of these plague cases marked and doorways. But the destruction of buildings, which were thought to be plague infested, was an important part of government policy at this time. In addition, a great deal of experimentation took place with the bodies of Indians. In this particular case, an experiment with the use of a serum to try to prevent plague, but in other cases, the development of an anti-plague inoculation, which was then widely used in India from the late 1890s onwards. So there's something very corporeal, something very bodily about the nature of this engagement. And there are also scenes, hospitals and segregation camps, to which many hundreds of people were taken during the height of the plague pandemic. You see an existing hospital being converted to plague purposes, and that rather curious trolley in the foreground is used for transporting bodies to the hospitals and to the morgues. And then we have photographs of individual sufferers, people who are being treated for plague, people who are recovering from plague, or perhaps more commonly, scenes from cremation grounds. And it's perhaps particularly this kind of image of cremation grounds, of the wholesale cremation of the plague dead, which has particular resonance for scenes of India in 2020 and 2021. And indeed, there was a great deal of discussion about whether it was appropriate or not to show these kinds of scenes in films, in photographs, and so on. Are they intrusive on the dead as well as on the living? And also scenes showing us the symptoms of various kinds of plague parties, including European troops who were very much involved in house searches and other kinds of control measures, but also Indian soldiers right down to the subalterns who you see at the bottom here, the people actually were involved in demolishing houses or other kinds of sanitary measures. So, in a sense, what I'm saying here is that photography gives us a very visual insight into the nature of this particular epidemic and something of the character of the experience of that plague. So, why were so many of these photographs being taken? Well, one factor was, of course, the very nature of photography itself, that it provides a very useful and immediate medium for recording what was going on. But we also have to recognize that this moment of play in the 1890s was a real moment of imperial crisis. The fear was that having come from Hong Kong and China, plague would not only establish itself in India, but then spread from India to the Middle East and more especially to Europe and to North America. The government of India was under enormous pressure to show to the international community that it was doing something about plague, that it was going to stop plague in its tracks in India, and that Europe would therefore be threatened, and that therefore trade with India continued to be safe and viable. So many of these photographs serve a kind of propaganda purpose to show an imperial government rigorously at work containing the plague epidemic. But another side of this was that these precise measures, these widespread interventionist measures, produced a major backlash against the British administration in India, created a great deal of resentment, and we'll see a particular example of that a bit later on. So in a way, the photographs are meant to be a kind of gesture of reassurance. Not just that things have been done, but that Indians are participating in these sanitary measures and sharing and joining when the plague was spreading elsewhere. So photographs are very much a cusp of what is imperial policy and what is an attempt to accommodate or overcome the opposition of the nationalists who are emerging at this time. And then we have photographs of what are called in the text at the time, lady doctors and English nurses. And this really brings me to the second strand of my discussion about women, doctors, and nurses in India at the time. It was felt that India was not capable of dealing with the plague pandemic by itself and with its existing resources. And it was decided as a matter of imperial policy that the British need to inject into India a large number of doctors and nurses coming from Britain itself. And in 1897-98, they recruited a large number of doctors and nurses specifically to address the problem of plague. And this was particularly important in the Indian context because there were enormous sensitivities around women's bodies in it. Male physicians should not have contact with female patients, and therefore there was a particular niche in India for women doctors and nurses to fulfill that practical role of providing medical assistance and support to the Indian population, and particularly to women and children. So in 1897-98, a substantial number of doctors were recruited, most of them were male. I don't know the exact figure, perhaps 40 or 50 of them. And in addition, perhaps 60 or 70 so-called English nurses. And they were employed in India on what seemed to be very privileged terms. They were paid much more than anyone else in India at the time. They had short contracts, which covered the expenses of traveling to India, their equipment, their dress, and all these other considerations. So we have here a situation in which there is a new arrival of medical personnel in India. And if you contrast that with what we see in this picture, this is a Grant Medical College, one of the older medical colleges in India, established in 1846. And in the 1880s, as the women's medical movement began to develop in India, Grant Medical College was one of the colleges which was said to open its doors to women as medical students. Looks to me as though the doors are rather firmly closed in this picture. I also think that in order to get a chair in Grantham College, you have to be white and male and have a lot of boots. But these photographs are actually very interesting for other reasons, because the women in this photograph represent a great diversity of communities. There are women here who are domiciled Europeans, I think of European origin, but brought up in India. There are people of race. There are Hindus of various castes and communities. There are Muslims, Parsis, and Jews. So in a sense, what you see here is the cosmopolitan nature of women's medical profession in India by the 1890s and 1900s. What you don't see in this photograph, and what is conspicuous from a present day point of view, is the absence of anyone from a so-called untouchable or Dalit community. And I'll come back to significance of that a bit later on. But Grantham College does provide us with some kind of photographic insight into the diversity of the existing community of women doctors and deep nurses in this period. So what begins to happen is a degree of resentment against the arrival of these so-called plague nurses. I can't resist the temptation of discussion to use plague not only to refer to epidemiology, to a specific disease, we might plague, but the idea of plague in a more metaphorical sense as meaning something which is oppressive and irksome. And the use of that phrase, plague nurses, perhaps rather aptly captures that sense that these newly arrived nurses were not only dealing with plague, but were themselves, in the local view, something of a plague themselves. So this is a message, a letter from one of the principal newspapers in Bombay, the Times of India, October 1899, on the arrival of 21 more nurses from Britain, and says, what need is there in this heavy expenditure? Are these nurses who are strangers in a strange land better able to cope with disease than Anglo-Indian, Eurasian, and native nurses who have so devotedly given up their whole time and life for the last 3 years to this work? The pay they receive from their labours is one third of that of that received by the English ones. It goes on, to show your sympathy with patients, we must know the language thoroughly and also the habits, so that we can look after them as if they belonged to ourselves, and not let them feel that we know there's a great God between them and us. Seems to be an extraordinarily revealing kind of statement, not just about the significance of language, and part of what I'm dealing with here is the tension between what is visible and what is spoken, but also the whole idea that actually these nurses are part of an enterprise which tries to make people feel they belong to them, and not to let them feel that we know there is a great gulf fixed between them and us. The fetishisms of these nurses continues in other contexts as well. Here is a letter from the same newspaper about the award of the Kaiser Hind honours. These were quite complex honours handed out by the government of India to various kinds of people who serve the public or the administration in India. They can find and brought many noble works to the front, and the commanders rejoice to see them honored. Looking down the long list of Kaiser Hind honors, there's an omission which will strike everyone. The whole community of nurses who, from the first case of plague in the city, have been on duty day and night, amidst never to be forgotten scenes and after the wards, where all their merits honors. I don't now speak of the later reinforcements of nurses from home, i.e. those who were being bussed in or parachuted in from Britain for purpose, but those recruited in India itself, who bore the burden and heat of the day and earned their high reputation as plague nurses, not at the end of the battle, and so on. So you get some sense of the resentment among the existing nursing community in India at the arrival of these highly paid outsiders. Another sentiment is time expressed by a medical administrator in the city of Pune, which I'll come back to again in a moment, on these so-called English nurses. Ignorance of the people, their speech, again, the question of language, their taste, their food, handicaps the nurses in supery. The language of pantomime is weary of patient and nurse. In order that they can speak to the patients, they have to gesture to them in various ways. Their presence was glorious, but it was not nurse. Seems to be a rather tame comment. So, how much that kind of resentment against the nurses also transferred to the women doctors is difficult to say, but I think it gives you some idea of the resentment that was around the theme of alienation, which existed at that moment in time. I don't know exactly how many white women doctors were brought into India at this time. I know at least three. One of whom gets a mention in Simon Charles' recent book about plague. Alice Cawthorne, who was recruited at the same time as Marion Hunter. She served in parts of the Bombay presidency and established a reputation as someone who did injections, inoculations, and also wrote a couple of articles about the way in which plague could be transmitted by squirrels as well as by rats. This is a time when the actual means by which plague is being transmitted is being understood. But my interest here is in Marion Hunter. And this is one of the few pictures I have of her which shows her in any detail. I don't even know exactly when she was born, but I think she was about 33 years old by the time she went to India. She'd been trained in London. She had a degree of licentiate as a servant of apothecaries. And she was therefore part of that second generation of women doctors in Britain after Sir Richard Blake and Gavin Hanson in the previous decades. But he was appointed to India as a special case. And this is where it becomes rather more interesting. She had a famous uncle. Her uncle was Sir William Wilson Hunter. And he was probably one of the most famous bureaucrats in India in the second half of the 19th century. Not only was he an administrator, but he wrote a number of books about the history of India and British administration in India. He was also the person who set up and oversaw the production of the multiple volumes of the Imperial Gazetteer of India. So her uncle was an extremely famous man. And indeed, when the announcement is made of the arrival of the ship, in which she and other nurses and doctors arriving, it repeats twice in the space of a few column inches that she is the niece of Sir William Hunter. As far as I can tell, she was quite close to her uncle, because when she applied to the London School to be taken to be admitted, she cites Sir William as her closest living relative. And when he dies in 1900, she was there in England as one of the principal mourners. But in the eyes of many people, she got this job, this well-paid job in India, because of her connection with her uncle. And there's a lot of resentment about this amongst other members of the medical services in India. Why should she be given this farm job just because she happens to have a famous uncle? But when she arrives in India, having been recruited to very good notice, Marion Hunter is sent to the General Plague Hospital in Pune. Pune is one of the epicenters of the pandemic, the bubonic plague pandemic, as it is beginning to unfold in India. People from Bombay have traveled south to Pune and brought the plague with them. And though Pune has a major hospital, the Sussex Hospital, that hospital is not able to cope with the large number of plague cases and plague deaths that are occurring by 1897. So the British decided to set up a new improvised plague hospital in Pune. And this gives you a general view of the site. Pune itself lies over there. This is vacant space, the Sangam, just on the outside of the city. And whereas the old city itself was thought to be congested and dirty and plague prone, the idea was by creating this new site it possible to establish an orderly sanitary city in which plague could be effectively combated and overcome. So all of these buildings were laid out with a view to sanitary correctness and the efficient dealing with plague. The hospital, in fact, accommodated about 500 patients at any one time, but such was the mortality of plague that half of those patients died. So Hunter was witness to an enormous mortality taking place even within this sanitary environment. There's something else we also need to note, and that is that Pune was a very proud city. It had been the centre of the Maratha Empire until 1818. It had a large percentage of high-class Hindus, Brahmins, who were very resentful of the measures the British imposed upon the city in their attempt to suppress the plague. There were not only house searches, but sometimes house searches taking place several times over, in which troops, in particular soldiers, British soldiers, would enter the houses, sometimes break into the kitchens, into the private prayer rooms, and generally, in the view of the high caste Hindus, violate their society with their hobnail boots and their aggressive intervention. And indeed, one of the officers, the plague commissioner, who was appointed to oversee operations in Pune, called W.C. Brand, was assassinated shortly before Hunter arrived, because he was seen to be at the center of these aggressive and insensitive measures. So part of the purpose of this new hospital was to take plague operations away from that city and move them to a more neutral and effective site. We have a large number of photographs of the hospital and the stuff on the bed. This is part of a series of photographs taken by a professional photographer, a man called F.B. Stewart, who perhaps was more accustomed to taking photographs of soldiers in their military ranks rather than patients or nurses and doctors in hospital. But it gives you a rather nice idea of the principal characters involved. You can see at the back there the farms and the Indian educated assistants. And then below them, several of the nurses, the English nurses, recruited to work in this particular camp. And then within the area that I've highlighted, from left to right, Erasmus Diaz, who was a girl of the descendant of infantry, who was the general medical officer for this camp. And this is Hunter sitting here, a rather awkward looking straw hat. Next to her is Lloyd Jones, who was the medical officer in charge of the whole camp, and a man called Adams. And we particularly need to note Adams because he figures rather prominently in the story. But he too was somebody who came up to India specifically to look on plague measures. So that gives you an idea of the European element. But this particular photograph, which captures most of the employees, some 200 people working in this plague hospital, they're not only you have the long rows of Indians and Europeans, but you also have a kind of echo of many of the domestic photographs that Europeans took in India. Quite common in those photographs to have not just the European household in the center of the photograph, but also their servants sitting down. Over here is a cook with his rolling pin, and here is the laundryman, with his pail, and over the right here, if you can't see him, is the waterman with his butler and his bags of water. So it's almost like a projection of a domestic scene transferred to this plague camp and to its occupants. Other things strike me about this photograph too. It's an attempt, as I said earlier, to suggest that things were being done efficiently and in an orderly manner. Rather than being panic, disorganization, here we have things carefully organized and orchestrated between these various members of staff. But particularly interesting to me This is rather women here at the bottom, with their head covered by their sarks. These are Dalits. These are Tajiks. These are members of the Mahar community. And that's interesting because they're referred to as ward Islas. Now, Ida is originally a Portuguese word. It came to refer to a nurse working in a European household who looked after white children. Here, that role has been transferred to a medical context, and these ward Islas actually carried out much of the work in the wards themselves. The English nurses didn't like dealing with shit and vomit and nasty poultices, bandages. All that rough work, as it's called, was dedicated to these Mahar women. So, in a sense, what you see here is a kind of intimacy, a kind of potency of bringing together all those social elements as if they congeal into a single whole. It is a picture of reassurance. Somewhere, Ramaji Guha wrote an article about the Buddha not being at home in empire. But these kinds of pictures almost suggest, propagandistically, that when you were at home in India, look at them seated here with their servants and their associates, so on. And then we have a number of photographs of Marion Hunter in the wards. This is one of the children's wards. These are black concrete markings, but they're actually blankets which were supplied to children. This is Hunter here. Lloyd Jones over there on the left, and a couple of mid-sized batmen. You can see from this something of the improvised nature of the buildings themselves. It's now a picture of Hunter, this time in a silver turkey, again with 30 instructions, but with several of these organized actually in photograph as well. In all of these pictures, it seems to me that Hunter appears rather diffident. Perhaps even shy, or perhaps just aware of the responsibilities placed upon her. This is the best photograph I have of her, rather fancy dressed in a silk blouse, along with Lloyd Jones and Dr. March, one of the other physicians in the cast. It's meant to show the laboratory at the Clay Hospital, and there are microscopes here to demonstrate to it. And this particular photograph was used a number of times to demonstrate how the British were tackling plague in India. Here's here, for example, in a famous photograph, one that you might have illustrated in newspapers in London at the time. So, in a sense, we're beginning to see here Hunter as a relatively high profile figure who symbolizes the activities of the British in dealing actively and scientifically with plague. But it's now a version of that photograph taken at the same time, in which we see Lloyd Jones and Marsh again and Marion Hunter on the right hand side here. But this is from the album of Dr. Adam, the man I referred to now. And Adams, I think, probably loathed Marion Hunter. Partly because he felt that the women and children's wards, which had initially been entrusted to him, had been given away to Marion Hunter, that she was only there because she had a famous uncle, and he questioned whether she was actually a follower of the doctor at all. So in his album, where he scribbles various things about these photographs, he always refers to her as Miss Hunter and never as Dr. Hunter. And particularly the inscription on this photograph reads something about this being the this is made in addition to the hospital as a bacterial laboratory. Dr. Marsh, who was appointed to our place, and was going to take charge of the camp at Retty in our SIND, is seen examining the growth of the plague bacillus in a test tube. Dr. Jones is tired of looking through a microscope that has a specimen under it, and Ms. Hunter doesn't seem to be doing very much. And I think that captures, if you like, an aspect of discrimination against her as a woman doctor. It captures something of the extent to which, if you like, this was part of her personal plague, Perhaps he wasn't respected and treated equal by some of the colleagues in his plague hospital. But he didn't stay very long in India or Pune, and by the 6th of March, less than 6 months after she arrived, he was given a farewell event in which a number of very flattering and favourable things were said in her honour, particularly by Lloyd Jones, who was in charge of the campus hall. He refers to her as a brilliant colleague and a hard-working, conscientious medical officer, and he refers to great age in obtaining clothing for the sick. She was unremitting in attention to wards, and her ward honours, again, a critical factor here, reached a high stage of efficiency. Dr. Hunter carries home with her a large experience of plague, leaving behind her those who are most grateful for her kindness, courtesy, and patience, as well as staff. And then in her reply, she says something which I think is quite clear. She said she found herself as a female medical officer rather awkward at first. It was difficult to get home, a male doctor has his club, and could soon make friends. As far as I can tell, she was not housed with the nurses. The nurses were an inferior group. She was probably living by herself. She certainly wasn't living with the male doctors. She must have had, in many ways, a lonely, rather awkward experience. But she also goes on in her remarks to say she would desire to tender her thanks to the IRs also, who have been devoted to their care and attention. She could not thank them as she wished, as she did not know the language. So the intimacy of seeing those photographs in which the ward IRs are sitting at her feet, there's photographs of her in the wards themselves, in which she's obviously working alongside the ward IRs, something that is inhibited by her inability even to speak their language, Marathi, in everyday conversation. And interestingly enough, when she returns from India, she goes back to London via Egypt. She stops off in Alexandria to give some advice on the plague there. She arrives back in London, and it seems to me there's an extraordinary turnaround in the attitudes that she represents. She wrote a number of articles about her experiences in India. She gave a number of talks, particularly to women's medical associations and nursing groups on her return to Britain. This is an extract from an article she wrote, widely cited, in the magazine journal 19th Century. And it seems to me to epitomize the most colonial and imperious of attitudes towards Indians, despite the fact that she'd been saying only a few weeks earlier how much she valued the contribution. She says, in dealing with the natives, so she immediately falls back upon that generalizing term to encompass all castes and communities because of their high and low education or not. It has to be borne in mind that an Englishman seems to have turned her back on her gender identity, not just because it was common practice to use the masculine in a generalized way, but also because it seems as though the imperial voice is a masculine voice. An Englishman meets with a new would look at this on account of, which goes to the whole list, caste prejudices, superstition, paganism, native ignorance, distrust of sanitation, the astonishment of many native officials, the existence among natives of a Freemasonry, which enables them to conceal sick or dead friends in a truly wonderful manner. That they themselves keep the epidemic alive by their conduct never seems to occur to them. In a sense, it's their fault. Plague, it's there, but we can't deal with it. It's only through the intervention of Europeans, like herself, that these kinds of things. Yeah. So, in an extraordinary way, she seems to have relapsed from her intimate association with the Ayers and other Indians in the camp, and fallen back on interior imperial stereotypes of the kind which perhaps her famous uncle might have employed in some of his works. I can't entirely explain why she does that. Maybe it's because her audience back in Britain expects these kinds of imperial sentiments to be voiced. Perhaps because the experience of being in Pune was something that actually was quite traumatic for her, and that she hasn't actually managed to process that experience in ways which could contribute to a more open and enlightened attitude. So it's hard to say exactly why, but she does seem to become a rather different person from what she was when she was in the plane car. And it's worth stressing that while she was in India, she was virtually only in one place in Pune and in one building, virtually. So it's very difficult for her to actually speak with any kind of authority about the vastness of India and the multitude of its cities and peoples. What's also interesting is that Hunter did not become part of the imperial service. As far as I know, this was her only visit to India. And shortly after she returned from India, she took up a career in medical education for children in London. She died in the 1930s in Scotland, in a very modest funeral was held for her, quite in contrast with the grand funeral of her uncle some 30 years earlier. So where does this link mean? And in a sense, it's demonstrably absurd for me to talk about Dr. Hunter's plague. There are millions of people who died of plague in India in this period. He was not one of them. As far as I know, he didn't fall sick with plague, although certainly some of these European doctors did die of plague, and certainly one of the nurses at this particular hospital in Pune died of plague when she was there. Perhaps that too was part of the trauma of experience. Hunter was not responsible for any innovation treatment. She was not responsible for writing any article, making discoveries. In that sense, again, it seems absurd to call this Dr. Hunter's plague. But in a curious way, on her return from India, she became an instant authority on the plague on India. Her views were widely cited and commended. Some of the photographs I've shown you circulated quite widely in Britain as a demonstration of when she and others were working to combat plague in India. So in a sense, she became the voice of plague. She became the image of plague control as far as many British people were concerned in the following 5 or 10 years. In addition to that, I also find it interesting that she has, as it were, these more personal plagues. The difficulty of having a famous uncle and the enormous expectations that must have created. The difficulty of being a white doctor, a white female doctor, alongside male colleagues and nurses who didn't share her social position. And the discrimination she no doubt felt as being somebody who was perhaps in some ways out of place in this imperial context. So I have no definitive conclusion for you here, but I'm trying to suggest the value of taking Hunter's case and the photographs that surround it as a way of providing a kind of microcosm for our historical investigation of an enormous pandemic and epidemic. And perhaps only through these more intimate moments and these more complicated moments that I have some real sense of the experience of working with plague and some sense of what those enormous numbers of plague dead and plague sick actually mean in more personal terms. So in that sense, I think there is a validity in calling this Dr. Hunter's plague. Thank you.